participate in Operation Christmas Child once again. Some of the things that you can start collecting for the Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes are school supplies. Next, I would like to let you know about something that I am planning to start for the youth group. Sometime soon, I am hoping to start Wednesday night game nights, which is going to be the start of the DC Youth Center. At the DC Youth Center, we'll have plenty of video games and board games, and lots of other things that teenagers will love to play. If you would like to donate any of your old video games or board games, please let me know and I'll be happy to take them. Right now, I do not have a set start date, but I'll let you know when it's ready to open. We'll continue to have youth at 1 o'clock on Sundays, where we'll play some games and we'll have a discussion. Those are all the announcements that we have today. So I hope you have a great rest of your day, and please enjoy the service.
Thank you. up in our hearts, Lord. Stir it up in our hearts, Lord. Stir it up in our hearts, a passion for your name. Stir it up in our hearts, Lord. Stir it up in our hearts, Lord. Stir it up in our hearts, a passion for your name. Stir it up in our hearts, Lord. Stir it up in our hearts, Lord. Stir it up in our hearts, passion for your name. Stir it up in our hearts, Lord. Stir it up in our hearts, Lord. Stir it up in our hearts, passion for your name. Stir it up in our hearts, Lord. Stir it up in our hearts, Lord. Stir it up in our hearts, passion for your name.
Place, Lord, have Hallelujah. Amen. Freedom. Freedom in this place, God. Break every chain. Break every bondage. Break every mindset. And Lord God, may your presence and your fire, your blood, even consume up the doors of this place. On that highway, people driving by, they'll be amazed at the presence of God exudes from this place. In our homes, in our neighborhoods, oh God, that you do a mighty, mighty work, that your Holy Spirit has his way. Father, move today in miracles and signs and wonders in ways that we haven't seen, the ways we've been longing for. God, get our minds off of our situations and our circumstances. Get our heart and mind and our eyes on you. Consume us with your fire today. Background, but that's okay. So good. and egg. You know, I was thinking about this, and a lot of us take for granted the presence of God. I was thinking about this week when I was in the church and praying and everything, and it's like, do you remember the way it used to be about God? That was not a good sin. It wasn't for me. You know, I was a mess. Just torment in my mind. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It was bad. It was bad. And now, peace. Amen. And I've been reading this book, Hunting Expectancy. And today, I want you to raise up your level of expectancy and what God wants to do today. Amen?
Amen.
Because expectancy is belief. And we got an amazing God to believe in. That song that I gave them, they did a good job in praying this song. And it says, fill us anew. And one of our prophetic people saw people with like embers on their hearts. Well, you know what? When there is an ember, that thing is going to be a fire. Amen?
Amen.
We just have to wait on and believe and expect the Holy Spirit going to blow those embers. Amen?
Amen?
And then the other thing says consuming fire, fan to flame, passion for your name, rushing wind, power from on high. Think of that. Set the captives free. Let your glory fall in this place. Amen? Now we're believing for a 100-mile radius around Grand Island for revival. Amen?
Amen?
And it goes from like up by O'Neill, Stewart to Gothenburg to, Smith Center, Mankato, Osborne, Kansas, bless their heart, all the way to Lincoln. And right, I want to share with you, I had like this vision, and it was like a circle, and I saw these wood pieces put on the edge of the circle, and I said, Lord, what is it? And he said, you have to have tinder wood before you have a fire, amen?
Amen.
Now the tinder wood, what do you think it is? What's the tinder wood? For fire in the kingdom of God is prayer. Amen? It's prayer. So the more we pray and pray to that radius, right? We are going to see miracles happen. You guys are in New York. You're right in that thing. And you're down in Geneva, wherever you are. I mean, people are traveling in St. Paul, the area already. So I'm excited. You can get a copy of this later if you want it. So you can pray for it. And right now, I want you to just take a minute, focus on the Lord. You're going to raise your hands, do whatever you want to do. But I'm, by the word that we're given, I'm going to decree that the Holy Spirit is going to stir your heart today, break mindsets, and blow on you in the fire of God. Amen?
Amen.
So let's just take a minute and do that. Breathe in your hands, relax, whatever you want to do. But the main thing is focus on the Lord right now. Alright? Hallelujah. Shut up, buddy. May the word of knowledge, may the word of wisdom, may the word of understanding come forth from this Father. Blow, Holy Spirit, into those embers. You may think of a fire, and my fire will die up sometimes, and I have to blow on that thing, and then it comes to a flame again. Blow, Holy Spirit, right now. Yeah. Blow into our hearts. Blow into those areas that we've laid down. Blow into those areas that we have false mindsets of religion instead of freedom. Blow into those areas in our life that we've kind of put aside and put into the corner and maybe shut the door and don't want anybody to go in there. Blow on that fire, Holy Spirit, right now. In a mighty way. Blow, Holy Spirit. The breath of heaven upon our hearts. The breath of heaven upon our minds. The breath of heaven upon our bodies. There's areas in your body right now that you need healing. Cry out to God for healing. He's here for healing. Holy Spirit, blow in a mighty way. Your word says we don't see how you're blowing sometimes, but we see by the movements of the trees and the blowing and the wind. And we believe that right now. That each one that has a need here today, that need will be met. Amen? Yes. We expect it, Holy Spirit, to be done. Because of who you are. You are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And there is nobody that can stand in the way. Demons cannot stand in the way. Amen. When you want to move. And I believe, God, that you're going to move in a sovereign way upon our hearts and our lives. You're going to move in a mighty way today. In ways that we've been longing for and just desiring. We break off the spirit of slumber and sloth that has tried to keep us down. No more. Freedom in our bodies. Freedom in our minds. Freedom, God. Just like that word that was spoken. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Amen? Amen. And we believe that. Not about us. It's not about any of us. But it's by your Spirit. Amen. I was just reading a little bit about Azusa Street. Last night, my heart was burning and crying out for what God wants to do. God's already done, amen. We just have to line up with Him. What's kind of interesting, you know, William Seymour was an African-American, and he, because of the crow laws and all that down south, he couldn't even be in the classroom. He would have to stand outside by the window and hear the teaching. And when it rained, they allowed him to be in the hallway and they leave the door open and he could listen. But before that, down in Topeka, Kansas, they were praying. That's the key in him. They were praying. If they didn't, can't get Herman right from my voice, by the way, amen. They were praying days and days and days. And they're reading about in the book of Acts about the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. And one lady, Agnes Osmond, from Beatrice, Nebraska. Amen. She was the first person, I mean, there were other people, but in that time, in the early 1900s, she was the first person baptized in the Holy Spirit and spoke with other languages. From Beatrice, Nebraska. Amen. That's awesome. Nebraska. Yeah. And when I was just reading that, I thought, Nebraska. We're in the heartland. We're in the heart of the U.S. I mean, why not learn more? So anyway, William Seymour went out to Los Angeles. They started in a little house, but they outgrew it. They're actually concerned about the foundation of the house because so many people in it. They moved into this little mission thing. And why I'm sharing this is, he wasn't very well educated. I was listening to a song this week by Petra. Yes, in the 90s. Some of those 90s songs got really good messages, by the way. Some of these, and we won't go there, but anyway, the message was, you don't need a Bible degree. You don't need all this intellect. All you have to do is lift Jesus high. Think of that. That's all you need to do. It's not complicated. I think we've made it a little complicated, don't y'all? Yeah. I used to live in Louisiana, Texas City also. But, you know, I just think we make it a little complicated. And William Seymour was just obedient to the Holy Spirit. They saw limbs grow out. They saw people healed of multiple things. One guy said, he was a minister, and he said, I was baptized in divine love. It was so much love, I could hardly contain it. Wouldn't it be nice to have that today? Baptize us, Lord, in divine love. And why I start studying it is because people saw like a fire over the building and actually called fire trucks. Now I don't know if they actually saw it physically or in the spirit, the prophetic people, you know what I mean? We've had prophetic people right now, last couple weeks, month. See a fire over destiny. Okay? But we walk in the building, or we walk in our lights, or our homes, we have people come to our home and they go, wow, it's so peaceful. It's just normal to me. When you hear in the presence of God, it's just normal. Amen? Amen. Don't take it for granted. Remember where you were before. Amen. I'm not the same person anymore. I'm crazy, but I'm not the same person. I mean, I'm a new creature, new creation, seated at the right hand of the Father in Christ Jesus. We are one. We are one in body. When one of us hurts, the other one hurts. Amen. Wow. That's funny. When I was preparing, and I asked, oh, by the way, we need prayer right now. Lord, we just bless Aurora. We just bless Aurora and Pastor Tim and the band over there with your love and with your Spirit and with your anointing. Yeah. And touch people's hearts. And Lord, prayer sometimes is kind of hard. And I just ask you, Holy Spirit, to blow into that area and break those hard hearts of religion. And open up their mindsets, amen. And it's just, yeah, just give it to them, Lord. Freedom. Amen. Well, woo-woo. Yeah. You know, it's we'll figure it out. Believe me. Worked earlier. Now there's 23 slides, so it better work. That's all I can take. All right.
Reboot. Anyway,
in the meantime.
Reboot.
Reboot? Yeah, that's usually the way to go, isn't it? We'll just kind of show what goes. Oh, yeah, there they are. Well, there we go. Anyway, the Holy Spirit, may the Holy Spirit breathe on your heart today. If you don't get anything out of it, think of that. May the Holy Spirit right now breathe on your heart. I want to see more people healed. I want to see more people set free. When I go into cases, I want to see people liberated. When I go into stores, when I drive through the community, your word says, Lord, that it's like a lamp everywhere we walk, everywhere we drive, we take it for the kingdom of God. We walk in our house. We see it in our neighborhood. I don't understand it. Christians are coming in. People are blessed. People are loving the Lord more. I mean, wow. Just by God's presence and His love. The power of fire. Wow. Fire is powerful. It's symbolized by love, passion, desire, rebirth. You know, sometimes you burn your grass, you get new grass. Resurrection, eternity, destruction, hope, and purification. My question to you, Dan, are you passionate about God? Think about it. For all that God has done, are you passionate for God? Or is this something you just come on Sundays for the rest of the week and just kind of do your own thing? I mean it. Are you passionate for God? You want revival? Where revival comes from is God dealing with our hearts. It does. You know, that's where it comes from. The Father has given it all. He's given His Son. Died for our sins. He's given us the Holy Spirit so we can walk our Christian walk out into the world and people are saved and people are set free. Amen? This is a picture that I got last night of New York City. Wow. Isn't that something? I mean, we've been having a little smoke. I'm surprised they got hit that hard that easy. But if you look at Minneapolis, and you look at Iowa, and thank God we live in the brass. I mean, but the fires in the West and in Canada are blowing through the winds all of America. It's nuts. I was thinking about it's like the dust bowls. You know, when the dust bowls, I'm not quite old enough for the dust bowl, but anyway, I read about it. Dust went all the way over to Washington, D.C. So fire is powerful in many ways. And fire has very unique qualities. That just startled me last night when I looked at it. That was when they had the California fires. That's the way the sky looked. This right should have a laser. That right there is at night. What happens is that one and that one and that one, they're like fire tornadoes. What happens is the fire, it goes up into the atmosphere, makes a cloud, but it's a hot cloud, and it swirls or whirls fire back on the earth like a tornado. It's nuts. Very unique qualities. The ancients believed that lightning was fire from the gods. If you look in the Bible, you see different scriptures, and they're talking about lightning coming from God judging with hail, or fire mixed with hail. Lightning. Now the amazing thing about lightning is this. Where fire is turned into plasma at about 1,500 degrees Fahrenheit. Lightning is about 50,000 degrees Fahrenheit, or five times hotter than the sun. And our Father sits on his throne, and lightning comes forth from his throne and his fire. Pretty amazing. Amen. Guys, this is our Father. Yeah. Father. When you look at normal fire, the orange is about 600 to 800 degrees Fahrenheit. Then it turns white, hotter, turns blue or violet. But still only about 1,200, 1,500 degrees Fahrenheit. 50,000 degrees Fahrenheit! It's amazing. The sun is about 10,000. And the center of it's about 27,000.
fire has very unique qualities. Now this week, you might have seen it already, the sun and the moon at night, they look kind of red. Now I don't want to pop anybody's bubble, okay? That's catalogical. Of the end times. Talk about blood moons. Alright? Beware. Discern the spirits of your guides. Really, I mean it. If you have a visitation from Jesus, which a lot of us have, ask, are you the Lord Jesus of Nazareth? You know, just don't assume any angel light can come and visit you, alright? Amen. Now the blood moons, I may be stepping on some toes, but when you look at the end times, why, you love this, why the moon looks red is because of now. The smoke goes up into the atmosphere and it makes it look that way. So when you have war and you have battles and you have smoke rising, you have that effect. Now, yeah, the eclipse and all that, but beware. Alright? We are believers that are grounded on the Word of God. The death, the burial, the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. We have ministering warring angels. We have guardian angels. Amen. We have a spirit realm that's amazing. The sun is like a ball of fire. We need it for our life. We need God's fire for our spiritual life. Remember when God was leading the Israelites through the desert. He led them by fire by night, pillar cloud by day, right? Exodus 13, 21, 22. And the Lord went before them by day in the pillar cloud to lead the way by night in the pillar of fire to give them light so as to go by day and night. He did not take away the pillar cloud by day or the pillar of fire by night from before his people. I don't know exactly what it looked like. That was my best rendition. Amen. Think about it. Fire. Protection. Light at night. Cloud. God's old fire. You know those, right? There's three things you need for fire, right? You gotta have fuel, you gotta have heat, and you have oxygen. Amen. So when we look at the fuel, all through the Old Testament, there is the animal, the grain, the sacrifices, right? They were a complete sacrifice. They were eliminated, burned completely. They were consumed by the fire. We, and we'll go to this from Romans, we are living sacrifices. Living. We don't have to die. Why? Jesus died for us to take care of the black sin that's in our heart. Now, the challenge as believers, someone said the other day, remember the WWJD? Oh, again, what would Jesus do? I'm going to shoot straight to the his. Is that all right? What would Jesus do walking in your home? What would Jesus do walking into your thoughts? What would Jesus do at work? What would he do in your car? That car thing, I almost blew it this week. Thank you. Holy Spirit must have helped me a lot. People were trying. I've been in some big cities, and sometimes people up here just don't drive real well.
Sometimes.
All the time.
They sit there and wait, and the light's already green. It's like, help me. I'll wait. I'm on a patient journey anyway. Anybody else?
A patient journey.
It's a good time to pray.
What?
A good time to pray.
It is. Anybody else on a patient journey?
Yes.
Or God has you on a seemingly wait and hold? Well, Jim, one of the things is on that journey is we need to be a living sacrifice. And all the stuff that really mattered in our life that doesn't matter anymore needs to be consumed. And when we do that, then he promotes us. It's crazy what the Bible says. You want to be promoted? You become a servant. It's crazy. It's not the world system, is it? Boom. Complete sacrifice. Give it all. Jesus paid the price for our sin. So we need to be a living sacrifice. Now you're going to love this. Sons of Aaron, the priest shall put fire on the altar. And lay wood in the order that the priest Aaron's son shall lay parts of the head and the fat in the order of the wood that is on the fire upon the altar. Herman, I could not talk that way a week ago. And the priest shall burn on the altar as burnt sacrifice, an offering made by fire, and a sweet aroma to the Lord. Now when I read the Bible, it's like, why does God need an aroma? Now you people that do meat, it smells good. When we barbecue and we do things, that's a pretty good aroma. And my neighbor is like, oh man, I want to go there. But God doesn't. I mean, whatever. Our obedience, our life, doing what we need to do, honors God and makes a sweet aroma. Amen. We are to be living sacrifices. I beseech you, Paul says, therefore, by the brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. God convicted me a couple weeks or a week ago. I'm starting to get up in the morning and exercise. Who says he can't teach old dog new tricks? And it's been a long time. But I'm supposed to exercise, eat healthier. I don't remember the other one. I got it with us. Eat healthy, exercise. Oh, yeah.
Sleep.
Read the word. And pray. Holy. What does it mean to be holy? It means to be set apart. If we are not set apart, if we don't look any different than anybody else in the world, are we walking in holiness? Just to the thought. Acceptable to God. I don't know about you guys, but I want to stand before the Lord and the Lord say, well done, my good and faithful servant. One of my biggest concerns is I'm not going to do what I need to do when he's given me something to do and the gift to do it. Anybody else feel that way? Do not be conformed to this world. Now, why would Paul say that? You know why? There is no freedom being conformed to this world. None. Now, I mean, what this means is you just do like the pietism and just escape the world? And no, absolutely not. I'm in the world all the time with people. And you are too. But the more that we walk in our living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is our reasonable service. See that? It's reasonable. It makes sense. Why wouldn't it? Paul says. It's going to make sense because of what Jesus did for us and the price that it cost and the kingdom of God and the mightiness of the Father and the angels that are on fire and the fire that comes from his throne. It's common sense as a believer to give our lives to the Lord. Amen. And about renewing and be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Now, you can renew your mind by worship. You can renew your mind by reading the Word of God. And that's how you really renew your mind. Read the Word of God. If you're not reading the Word of God, that's one of my lists. I'm sorry, I forgot, Lord. If you're not reading the Word of God, what do you expect? I remember one guy telling me I actually had a lot of wisdom. This is when I was younger. I mean, I still think I have the wisdom, but he said, "How did you get so smart?" I said, "I read Proverbs chapter every day for a long time." The Bible says, when you read it, you'll be blessed. And it'll give you wisdom. And knowledge, and riches, and wealth. Wow. Miss, I started reading it. Renewing your mind that you may prove what is good and acceptable. Here we go. Never forget this scripture. What does it say? And the what? Perfect will of God. Something. Everybody wants the will of God. Want the will of God? There it is. Be a living sacrifice. Holy. Separated to God. Common sense. And renew your mind with the Word. And worship in the presence of God. And you know the will of God. Pretty easy. Right? Okay. That was the fuel. Now, one thing about fuel, the more pure it is, the more clean it burns. Right? The more garbage it's in it, the more contamination, the more chemicals, the more ugliness. Right? Sometimes when God is working in our life, when the fuel of our life is being burned, it can be kind of ugly. Amen? Okay. That's all right. I remember my spiritual dad in Minnesota, like I said, I had a messed up background. I had a lot of soul ties, you know, those are when you have relationships. get bound together. And just not good. And my mind was tormented one day, and I was a believer, but it's just like, God, help, what do I do? Well, I went down there, he prayed for me. I broke off mentally, emotionally, physically, spiritually, sexually, soul ties from people. If you haven't done that, do that. If you got stuff laying around from old boyfriends, girlfriends, whatever, get rid of it. It's a tie. It'll mess you up. So anyways, committed to his leadership. I broke it off. And I saw like a checkerboard with all the black spaces on like holes. And God just, by his grace and mercy, he just brought me right through all those holes and protected me. But the amazing thing was, when we got done, it was a beautiful fire of God, the anointing of God, burned it out of me. I didn't know who I was anymore. I was so used, and Herman was telling me this week, that when you have bondages broken off of you by God, sometimes we want to pick them up, the chains, and put them back on because it's comfortable. Well, anyway, it wasn't comfortable, so I just left them off, but I went to Kevin Marley's and I said, I feel so weird. I don't feel like myself anymore. They said, yes, that's awesome. You don't want to be that self anymore. and slowly the Holy Spirit just built up who he wanted me to be. Amen. So that's what I encourage you with. The heat. Anybody sometimes feel the heat? Sometimes I get too close to my fire. I love fire in my backyard, my little whatever it is, bell. Fire pit, that's what it is. I love fire. Sometimes it'll flicker and get a little hot at me. Beloved, do not think it's strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you. Well, what? Rejoice! To the extent that you partake of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory is revealed, that you may also be glad with exceeding joy. Now, I believe that, we get to heaven, we're going to be in God's glory, and it'll be glorious. Amen. I believe we can taste it right now. When God's glory comes on our life, guys, God is moving at a high level in this church right now. We're praying, man. It's just amazing the open heavens, what God is doing. He's about... Get your expectancy level from your 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5. Get it about 9 right now, maybe 10. And just allow God to fill you. Amen? He's doing it. If you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you. For the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. Sometimes it doesn't feel like a blessing, does it? On their part, he is blasphemed. But in your part, he is glorified. We're going to turn up the heat a little bit more here. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, as a thief, as an evildoer, as a busybody, body, and other people's matters. Amen? Let's be real. You want your heart rate for God? You want revival? It comes at a cost. Now, you have a choice when you read a scripture like that, just like I did when I was preparing. You either humble yourself and say, yes, Lord, forgive me. Amen? Or you rise up, I'm not that way, I don't do that, whatever. If you want to live another day of frogs, it's up to you, you know. The king Pharaoh, he had the ability to say, frogs go. Moses asked him, when do you want them gone? He says, tomorrow. You want to live with them another day. If you want to live another day, and the pain and the suffering, the bondages that you're dealing with, go ahead. All it takes is just say, Father, forgive me. Father, forgive me. You know, I repent a lot. I don't think I'm so unique. I mean, I know I've got a lot of issues, but I don't think I'm the only one that needs to repent like that. If I have a bad attitude in my heart towards someone in my family knows this. Sooner or later, I'm going to go to them, probably quicker than they may want. But I'm going to say, please forgive me. I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to do that. And then I go to God. I say, God, I don't want to be that way anymore. Amen. That's bad. My dog's leaving. I can leave it. I didn't get a lot of sleep. I'm laying on the chair, but I slept in, and the dog's barking in the room and finally gets left up. So God, he comes in, comes right into the living room, sits, looks at me. I needed about a half hour more sleep. And he starts barking at me. Like, wake up! I'm like, whoop! Why? You know? Just because you're up, I have to pick up. I'll have morning devotions. Guess what? I'll go be there. Like, leave me alone. You think that's silly that I have to repent for that attitude?
Well, I did.
And I love my dog more because of it. It's a great dog. Anyway. And yet, if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed. But let him glorify God in the matter. For the time has come. Look at this. Yeah, it is. For what? Judgment begins where? At the house of God. Why do you think that is? Got any ideas? Why does judgment begin with us first?
We're the example.
We're the example. Amen. Anybody else? Why is judgment? Start with us. What?
Divide your house.
Divide your house. Yeah. I mean, if it says you have strife or envy or jealousy or longing for people's positions or clawing or grabbing, is that the kingdom of God? Absolutely not. I don't know about you guys, but I'm getting to the place where I'm actually believing God's done a lot for me, a lot more than, you know, people say all the time that I deserve. But judgment begins in my house. Judgment begins in my temple of who I am. And judgment begins here. Amen.
Amen.
You know what I'm so excited about this message? When we actually walk it out and we have more freedom, people will be drawn to us. And we'll be able to reach out in freedom to those around us. And people will come into the kingdom of God. and miracles will happen, and then our bodies will be healed, and our minds will be healed. Isn't that exciting? It's not a negative thing. But it might feel like it. Is the heat turned up a little bit today? I mean, when I prepared this, the heat was turned up for me. Now, the amazing thing in the revival is that they had in the what they did when people fell asleep, they would stick a, Michael, maybe you could do this for people. They would stick a poke, like a stick, and it would wake them up. Because what happens is the body will war against the spirit. Your flesh will say, I don't want this. Amen. It will. Your body will hurt. This will hurt. That will hurt. You know, your mind will go haywire. You know, and the body will say, no. I don't want to be a living sacrifice. I want to jump off the altar. I don't like that. I don't, but, you know, I've kind of come to the point in my life, my age, that I don't know how much longer I have, but I want to be found faithful to the Lord. Amen? Yeah. Okay. Now, the heat is going to get even hotter. So it went from kind of that yellow, red, to white, to blue. Now it's going into purple. Now, you know what purple means? World. Amen. So where do you think the strongest heat's gonna come from? It's gonna come from God directly. Hear the heavenly voice. See that you do not refuse who him who speaks. In the context, he's talking about Sinai on fire, clouds, thunder, lightning. Even Moses was trembling. He humbled himself, amen, to go see God. And so God spoke at Sinai. And for, by the way, you guys that really love the word and like to study, start doing your own study on fire. I was blown away by how many times the scripture talks about fire. For if they did not escape who refused him who spoke on the earth, much more shall we not escape if we turn away from him who speaks from heaven, whose voice then shook the earth. Remember, Joseph began something else from God. But now he has promised, and yet once more I shake not only the earth, but also the heaven. Now this is yet once more indicates the removal of those things that cannot be shaken. Your salvation, if you humble yourself and walk in the best that you can in God, you may have issues, you may have stuff going on, but if you really do that in humility, you will not be shaken. And nothing can destroy you. No demon, no any circumstance, anything can destroy you. Because it says this, it says, things that are which made and things which cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, since we have receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us have grace, God's ability by which we may serve God acceptable with reverence and godly fear. I have learned the greatest freedom in my personal life and people that I read about is when we have reverence, godly fear for the Lord. And we humble ourselves when he deals with our hearts and our lives. There's freedom in that. There is. You aren't tormented in your mind. Your body's not waking up, having a hangover in the morning. You're not dealing with your thoughts and the shame of looking at magazines or internet or TV or whatever it is in your life that doesn't line up with what would Jesus do. There's freedom. Let us have grace by which we may serve God, accept the reverence and godly fear. For why? Why? Why do we do it? The bottom. Oh, some people can't see the GD. God is a consuming fire. That's why we do it. I remember a vision I had. Y'all see in the spirit realm, you know, my baggage. It's just like a little picture. Anyway, God's really dealing with, you know, y'all. I had it years ago, and I didn't think much about it. It's a prophetic vision. At the time, it really touched me. Every time I shared it, it touches people. But anyway, I love Minnesota. I was born and raised in Minnesota, and I love Harbor Eyes. In my neighborhood, I'll walk my dog. I'll walk my dog, and I'll get up to somebody that has a little ice on there that's more than rubber. But I put it. I just love it. Maybe I liked it because I would do it in our creek back home, and if I wasn't careful, I'd go way in the water. But anyway, so it's a challenge. But anyway, the Lord gave me this vision. And I was standing on ice. And I'm kind of thinking about what that means. It's not a good deal. You know, if you're standing on faulty, or the word thin ice, what does that mean to you? It's not good. I never thought of this. I was going to preach it today. Anyway, I'm on thin ice. And the ice starts crackling. I love it crack, but and I start falling. And falling. And falling. I don't like to fall. I don't know about y'all. But it's falling. And the Lord spoke to my heart and said, I am a consuming fire. Oh! He just got turned up on Darrow. And I felt, and it was like water and fire, but because it was ice cream, water, something. Anyway. And, there's nothing to hold on to. I tried stepping on the ice chunks and falling with it and holding me up. And I realized today even more that when you fall into God, it's all Him. Amen. You don't have to have crutches. You don't have to have things holding you up. Because He is everything. And I fell into that. I just want you to get that image. Falling into the love of God. Falling into the fire of God. that will burn a torch, every bondage, every mental garbage you're dealing with, every addiction, if you just fall into God. And don't try to do things, don't try to hold yourself up. Amen?
Amen.
Does that make sense? God is an all-consuming fire. Look at those. Oh, Jesus. He's all consuming. All consuming. Think about that. God is all consuming. He wants everything of us. Are we willing to give it? Now you say, yeah, I'm on the given. Yeah.
You know,
God accommodates us. Yeah, that vision I had was, I don't know, 14 years ago. Now he's convicted me that I was on thin ice, and I didn't even know I was on thin ice. And yet I'm still here. He loves us and he's willing to be patient with us. I remember being in Minnesota and my voice was gone totally. It's a miracle. It's more of a miracle. So I was praying one day, and I said, God, what's the problem? I'm going to blame Minnesota. What's the problem? Where are things going on the way they are? What's the problem? Guess what he said? You're the problem. Well, God, what does that mean? I'm afraid to ask anymore, you know. I guess that was the least so much God wants for us. All right. Talk about the fuel. Talk about the heat. Now we get excited about how fire burns. Amen. Oxygen. Wind or breath. So we see the embers, that means that they need to be lighted and fired and, breathe them. God can do it. Or he can do it. And breathe. Good. He breathes on us. Matthew 3:11. You're familiar with it. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. John is baptizing in the River Jordan. People are streaming from the area out there. I read the streaming multitudes. I thought it was one or two people. No, multitudes are coming. The Pharisees, religious people are going, what's going on here? I need to check it out. And they're happy about it because people are getting saved. But he is coming after me as mightier than I, John said, whose sandals are not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with what? Fire! Hallelujah. He'll baptize us with the Holy Spirit and fire. You know what baptism really means? Now, I was Catholic, and I was sprinkled, and I think I've been baptized like 3 times now. But immersed. God wants us immersed in the fire of God through the Holy Spirit. That's why He would show me when I was falling, I was being immersed in God. Immersed in God. You know, we will stand before the Lord, right? And our works on the earth, and Pastor Tim preached this in Corinthians, our works will be probably with the eyes and the fire of God will torch our works. You know what happens? The things that just didn't matter will go up and smoke. And things that matter will turn to gold and silver and jewels and whatever. And we'll bow and worship the Lord for what He did through our lives. But I guarantee you, there will be things in my life that will be torched. And they'll come. I know that. Not happy, but I know that. I remember a leader in Louisiana told me one time, he's praying to the Lord, asked the Holy Spirit, what's the most important thing that God for your kingdom and your glory? Now he raised the church up and 300 people and all this good stuff. And all these big things he did for God. And God spoke to him and said, you know, the most important thing you've done for my kingdom is when he went over to that guy that couldn't come to church and read the Bible to him every Friday. The Bible says if you give a cup of cold water, you'll be rewarded, right? If you visit somebody in prison, you'll be rewarded. If you're kind to people. So he will baptize us with the Holy Spirit and fire. Amen. I want to play a song for you, and then after the song, the worship team, come up. But I want you to look at your heart. Where is your heart at? Only you know your heart. Only God knows my heart. People can get an idea what the heart looks like, right? They can get an idea, but they really can't see my heart or the motives of my heart or what's going on in my heart. Amen? Well, I've got to see my heart. But if you want freedom, I can prophesy to the Lord. If you want freedom, and if you want peace that you've never dreamed of, humble yourself before God and allow Him to take that garbage from you. It may stink for a while. That's okay. Don't worry about it. Let's see if I can find my song in here. And I'm honored to preach today. I'm honored to allow God to work in my heart to prepare for this. And I'm honored to be at this church and this body with many saints that have walked for a long time in the Lord and have been such a blessing. And but I remember being down in Louisiana shocked. I almost said something I shouldn't say, but it shocked me a lot. And Larry Stockfield, church of 3,000 people. A lot of Black African, a lot of mix. It was beautiful. And one of my spiritual dads down there, see, I want to let you know this. when you see somebody in their life,
I do this. That's my wife, one of them. And then my dog.
I am who I am because of the Lord. But I am who I am because all the people that you don't see that have influenced my life, including many of you, we're not an island. So I've had spiritual dads, I've had spiritual moms, I've been blessed royally. We've been blessed royally with, but I submitted to it. Okay? Now you have to understand this. I sought it out. They didn't just come to me. They were nice to me. But I called them up Kip. I said, Kip, how are you doing today? Man, I'm struggling. You know, my dad just died. Mom, and I'm older, He says, well, Darryl, why don't we go for lunch? I said, okay. He told me this. He said, embrace it. I said, yeah, it's like embracing a cactus right now. I don't want to embrace it. He said, embrace it, Darryl. Now, it takes a lot of humility just to embrace a lot of stuff going on in your life. But God will see it through. Anyway, John Louise Hannah. I didn't lose my story. It was just a small rabbit hole. My godly spiritual mom and dad went to the altar and an altar. And Larry Sox said, you know what? Pointed them out and said, you know what, sometimes the people that are getting close to the Lord, and I walk up to the Lord for a while, are the first ones to humble themselves before God. Amen? I said some pretty interesting things today that were kind of piercing, but remember the message is the fire of God. So what do you expect? That could be a cakewalk, Philip. Amen? So, hey, you see that? I got one name, Fire, on there. Well, all my other ones. If you don't have Spotify, man. Yeah, it's good. All right. So I'm going to play this song. Come on, this time. If we have the plug-in. Oh, yeah. Technology. Just want you to listen to this one. Can you hear it, Dad? Mm-hmm. Listen to the words of the poem. You know what other words of the poem or urgent that you have? I believe God can touch you right where you are. But if you want prayer to be praying for people, as you talk to one another, shall be healed. Wrong one. And the wrong one. Here we go. I just listened to this last thing. It blew me away. It's a good way. It blew me away.
My mind, Lord, they are yours now and forever. Glory.
eyes on. You know, I've prayed for people, and my hands, and many people I have too, they'll get hot, healing people. And I just want to share one last thing about today's message. Galatians 1:10 says, we are to be a slave to God, not to man. Amen?
Amen.
The greatest freedom I've ever found in my life is when I realized that I'm a slave to God and not to man. My spiritual mom helped me on this journey. And when I realized it became revelation in my heart, I started laughing uncontrollably at work. I mean, go down to the post offices of Louisiana and giggle to my, you know. What are you happy about? So that's what I heard today. There's some pretty pointed things that were said today. But I am a slave to God, not man. Amen? And I love you. You're my family. Alright? My mom and dad are gone. You're my family. I love you guys so much. But I encourage you, be a slave to God and not man. It's so freeing. Do I do it great old? Absolutely not. But I'm a lot better than you. I love you guys so much. I want to see God move in a mighty way through the Holy Spirit, through this church, and people are healed and salvation, and people start coming here, and people are set free. Amen. So, the altar is open. You can kneel wherever you want. You can come up for prayer and worship. Team will continue to lead us. Hallelujah. Amen. If you need to go, that's fine too. What do we need to do?
Thank you for the cross that you